degree in math and economics, so X is an unknown. And usually, I think I liked mathematics when X was very simple. You could solve it and it had a finite answer. As math gets a bit more complicated, X can be, starts to take on all sorts of different shapes and sizes. At that point, I said enough. But in a lot of ways, it reminds me of Nigeria. Is X unsolvable or is X a problem that has many solutions? I think Nigeria is solvable, and that's for me what I'm going to talk about in regards to X. Nigeria, for a lot of us, we know the issues. Our broken nation, broken infrastructure, bad roads, light, poverty in our minds and souls, dysfunctional social services, the list goes on and on and on. But the way most of us look at Nigeria is like a box. So the Nigeria that we know that has all these challenges defines the space that we live. And then we live in one little part of it, that's me in the corner, and we just focus on how do I work in this madness? How do I exist in this Nigeria? But how do you fix a country where the abnormal has become the norm? Where a four-year degree, if you get it in 6 years, you will throw a Thanksgiving party because you are finally out. But that's not normal. How do you solve a problem where doing the right thing is often looked down upon? And people will tell you, because they're encouraging you to take shortcuts. How do you solve a problem where there's no dignity in labor? Mosun spoke powerfully about the power in agriculture. But most of us want to become millionaires overnight. She told you of a 10-year struggle. But we want it today, we want it now, and we want it fast. How do you solve a problem where that is the norm? Where if you don't want to do that, you are the one that is abnormal. For most of us who do try, we feel disconnected, invisible, and powerless. Why do I say disconnected? From Chibok to Potiskum to Kotangora, all these places in the last 1 week, something has happened in them. For Chibok, it was the girls that were abducted over 215 days ago. Yesterday, their town has been taken over. So not only does Boko Haram have our girls, they also have their homes and they have their land. In Kotangora, it was a student in Minna who tried to blow herself up. In Kano, it was also a bomb. In all the Potiskum, it was a student that were shot in a bomb blast in an assembly line. All these cities might as well be in Burkina Faso or Chad. They sound so far away because we are disconnected from the realities that Nigeria today. And then some of us feel very invincible, as if nobody cares. Government doesn't care. Everybody is their own one-man local government. Your own water, at least in school, for the most part, you're still sheltered. But ask your parents. They'll sort out water, sort out power, sort out waste disposal. Nobody really cares. And lastly, powerless. What then do you do? Headlines from papers in the last 6 months. 200 killed in Borno town, 17 killed, 350 abducted, 219 abducted, 12 fear dead. I mean, the list goes on and on and on. We all feel extremely powerless. So what's the solution? Stop electing idiots. It sounds funny, but extremely important. Again, I say, stop electing idiots. Let's assume the X is the number, let's say 100. For those of you basic math, the larger your denominator, the smaller your result. So if you have 100 as your problem, and you divide it by one person, me, Yemi, you still get 100. If you divide it by two, Yemi and Mosun, you get 50. If you divide it by 50, some of us in here, you get two. Your problem becomes smaller. So very simply, the more people you have in the denominator doing something, taking action, speaking out, the more infinitesimal your problem becomes. It's really that simple. Now, elections is really an analogy. A little over four years ago, today I alluded to it when he was speaking, EIE organized a protest in Abuja. Very simple. As he said, president was missing. I mean, the person in that picture, and I particularly use that picture, is Audu Mekori, who couldn't make it today. But we just chose to use our voices. The president was missing. The vice president was not given powers. People were dying in Jos. We never imagined that we'd get this bad. We actually organized a protest for the rule of law to be established so that Mr. Jonathan could become the substantive president. So when people turn around to say and say EIE is anti-Jonathan, we all laugh because we actually put our lives in danger to make him president. Not because of him as a person, but because we were particular about the rule of law. So EIE organized that protest in March of 2010. After the protest, we were like, okay, what next? What do we want to do? And we decided to focus on elections. Very simply, We thought it was an opportunity for young people to use their voices beyond just protesting, but using it in a constructive manner to effect change. So we created an acronym, RSVP. For me personally, it's one of the most singular things I'm proud of, because RSVP, I think, captures everything a young Nigerian, or even a Nigerian, needs to do to lend their voice and have a say in solving the X of Nigeria. Simply, you register to vote. It's your civic responsibility. Yes, it can be tedious. Yes, it can be annoying. But it is your civic responsibility once you turn 18 to register to vote. Then select credible candidates. Pay attention. Listen to manifestos. Find out what they are saying. As Tunde rightly said, you will not find a messiah. It's not going to happen. However, find the least of the worst that you think you can find. Because at the end of the day, whether you like it or not, somebody will be elected and somebody will be in charge of your affairs. It's really that simple. V, show up on election day and vote. And lastly, protect your vote. P, on election day and the 4 years in between. How do you protect your vote in the 4 years in between? Pay attention. Everything that gets spent in this country in terms of money is your money. It is our collective money. It is our commonwealth. So the fact that someone chooses to take money that belongs to me and buy a house in Dubai, Joburg, London, New York, is a problem for me. I care because it's my money. You're not doing me a favor by building me a road. You're not doing me a favor by providing water. That is what I elected you to do. So I will not clap, neither will I dance. I will tell you, thank you for doing your job. And if you do not do your job, you get fired. Now, if any of you work in an establishment, if you don't do your jobs, there are penalties. And we should treat governance the same way. Let there be penalties for bad behavior. This is one of my favorite images in the world. The title says, the people don't know their power. So there's a supposed politician on that side, and all the people are on that side. Now, if all the people walk off that plank, what happens? And that's really what it is. And at the heart of politics and all that we're trying to do, really, is organizing. It is organizing, and it's organizing for change. And I put this to you. To solve the problem of Nigeria, we must organize. We don't have a choice. It is not enough to complain. It is not enough to say, I wish, or wait for a messiah. For the change that we want, we must organize for that change to happen. And I'll say this, student protests, and I'll use that as an example. I mean, students, you're young, you represent young Nigeria, you're in an intellectual establishment. It baffles me from when I grew up here to even now. It baffles me why students don't apply 1% of what you learn in terms of your organizing. You will burn buildings, you will destroy cars, you will destroy hostels, and you will say you don't want to go to school. Who loses? Your year extended by a year, the property you destroy, you invariably pay for because your fees will be slightly increased, or you'll be fined. So who loses? Why not sit down and think, okay, what are our issues? Fees are too high. This is this. What are the challenges? And then map out a plan. Organize and articulate clearly what is the problem and what are we proposing as a solution. A solution cannot be fees is not high, we're not paying. I'm sorry, a 15,000 naira education is no education. I grew up on this campus and I do not understand how people think it is justifiable to pay that low for your education. How much do you value it? I know some people here, the clothes you wear, they dress you from the Brazilian weave to the shoe you are wearing, a lot worth more than 15,000, and that's just one outfit, one day. How much more the education that will take you far in life? Now, I'm not saying everybody can afford it, don't get me wrong, but there are people that can afford to pay 100 times what they are paying now for school fees, and there are people that can't afford to pay a kobo. Now, why don't you take for those who can and supplement those who can't? Why must it be a general, everybody must pay the lowest common denominator? It makes a mockery of the education you are looking for. Number one. Number two, when you then protest, your articulation of your issues makes it extremely difficult for you to get support. Because I've asked students severally across campuses, okay, how much does your school generate? They don't know. How much do you get from the federal government? They don't know. How much does your school spend on you? You don't know. Oh, you're shouting that fees are too expensive, and you destroy property, extend your school year by 2 years, and then you complain that Nigeria is not working. Now, it works in the interest of government to divide students, and that's why NANS has become an appendage of government. You must decide that within this campus, you will take back how you are. I mean, because it's very symptomatic. If NANS or your student government decides how you are governed in school, it's the same group of people that will decide how you are governed outside of school. And if you don't take an active role, or participate, or be interested, you are on the losing end of the stick. I was speaking to a friend of mine who was in the audience, and he was telling me earlier that when he was in school, some people didn't know that former students were serving in IFE's SUG. Why would you know when you don't pay attention? So you have students, people who are not students, determining what happens to you who are a student. At the heart of it, again, is about organizing. And simply, what does organizing do? It connects us because we have a shared agenda, we have a shared plan. Number two, it makes us visible. You cannot miss a crowd. And number three, it gives us power. Because when we're united in what we're saying and demanding, we become extremely powerful. Two quotes that I like that speak to this for me. If an elephant has its foot on the tail of a mouse and you say you are neutral, the mouse would not appreciate your neutrality. And that's the same thing to the issue earlier raised about abuse. Someone is being slapped either by a boyfriend or a lecturer, and you decide that, oh, I don't know, na dem sabi. The person who is being hurt will not appreciate you turning your eye. And you never know. If you don't allow a process to be instituted so that someone pays for it, when it happens to you, that's how someone else will turn their eye as well. The second quote, you may never know what results from your action, but if you do nothing, there will be no result. This slide represents images of people who have died in the northern part of Nigeria. A lot of them faceless, nameless. We don't know them. The fact that we're disconnected from them does not take away their reality. The fact that we're not speaking does not take away their reality. Borno, Yobe, Adamawa, or all parts of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. And if we don't speak, there is no guarantee that it will not affect us in Oyo State. Lastly, this is one of my favorite quotes, and I'll end with this. Throughout history, it has been the inaction of those who could have acted, the indifference of those who should have known better, the silence of the voice of justice when it mattered most, that has made it possible for evil to triumph. Haile Selassie was a former, I guess, I want to call it, emperor of Ethiopia. Now, we can complain and we can want change. We can wait for a messiah to come and save us, or we can choose to organize. But while you are debating what you do, we can all continue to sip tea like Kermit the Frog, and this Nigeria will continue to do what it does. But I put it to you this. We really, as Jude said, don't have a choice. We must lend our voice, organize, so that we're not only connected, we're visible, and we're powerful. Thank you.